Thanks, Ken Corrigan. And I'm grateful for the opportunity to briefly comment on the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank Bill 2017. The bill, of course, is to obtain Oireachtas approval for Ireland to join the AIIB before the end of 2018. And it's a strong indication, I suppose, of dramatic changes which have taken place in the global economy over the past three decades. The rate of development of the BRICS economies in particular, despite recent slowdowns in growth, show the dramatic rise in the share of world production by the BRICS countries, and especially by China. And that economic development is mirrored in the Minister's decision to join the bank, which has 57 founding signatories from June 2015. And I know that up to 25 African, European and South American countries, including Ireland, Belgium and Canada, look set to join this year, including, of course, the original 52 countries which have ratified the bank's articles of agreement. Up to 77 countries may have joined by the end of the year. The AIIB, of course, was first proposed by President Xi Jinping of China in a Bali conference in October 2013. And President Xi seemed to envisage the bank as a new international development bank, raising major capital to fund roads, rail, power and communication grids across Asia. Although initially welcomed by Secretary of State John Kerry, the Obama administration remained very suspicious of the proposal and tried to dissuade its closest allies like Britain, Germany, Australia and South Korea from actually joining the organisation. And the Cameron Conservative government, perhaps anticipating the difficulties the current government or the government after the general election will face in Brexit, decided to become, of course, a founding member of the AIIB and its $100 billion fund. At the time, of course, human rights groups and promoters of multi-party democracy in Hong Kong and China felt that the UK was far too willing to placate the Chinese government, a communist government, and these concerns remain regarding our own government's proposal. And Deputy Barrett, Boyd Barrett, reminds me, of course, that many times in this House I've raised the situation with regard to Tibet and with regard to the Uyghur nation, huge territories of the People's Republic, which in fact, of course, are distinct nations, and where there's been grotesque repression over the last 40, 50 years. Many observers, of course, have questioned the need for a new Asian Development Bank, given the past role of the US-led World Bank and the International Monetary Fund and the Japanese-led Asian Development Bank. The Obama administration and other economists, of course, openly worried that China will use the AIIB to set its own Asian and global economic agendas and will ignore environmental protections and standards, human rights, especially of workers and large infrastructural projects, anti-corruption standards in tendering of awarding of contracts in particular, and also company governance standards. And we've seen, of course, the massive expansion of, I suppose, the Chinese government's economy or export economy and infrastructure development in so many countries of Africa, but which have raised many questions, in fact, about basic rights, especially for workers and for native populations. American governments, of course, have also long called on China to assume a leadership role in the global economy and prioritise infrastructure development in Asia. China also complained, of course, that the Bretton Woods architecture led by the US after World War II refuses to recognise the massively growing role of China in the world economy. The Asian Development Bank, of course, is dominated by Japan and I think headquartered in Tokyo, and its voting share of that bank is more than twice that of China. The US Congress, of course, also blocked, I think, for over 5 years an IMF proposal backed by President Obama to make China the third most powerful country at the IMF after the US and Japan. China, with 19% of the world economy, later saw its voting rights rise to only 6.2% of the total from under 4%, while the US share only fell from 16.7% to 16.5%. Of course, President Obama also didn't invite China to join the ill-fated American-led Trans-Pacific Partnership. But whatever about the US deep suspicions about China's ultimate economic political goals, it has been estimated that there is a $40 trillion basic infrastructure deficit down to 2030 in the less developed Asian economies. That's a huge amount of investment, can represent probably twice the size of the whole American economy, annual economy. And that is an $8 trillion investment is necessary just down to 2020 alone. And since its inception last year, the AIIB, which is headquartered in Beijing and led by Mr. Jing Li Kuhn, a former World Bank and ADB bank economist. It has funded what seems on the surface to be an impressive list of infrastructure projects, and often in cooperation with older multilateral institutions. And they include a $165 million loan for a power distribution system in Bangladesh, a $216 million loan for social housing in Indonesia, a $300 million loan for a hydropower plant in Pakistan, a $301 million loan for a port facility in Oman, loans to Tajikistan and Pakistan for improved new motorways, and a $600 million loan for the Trans-Anatolian pipeline, the TANAP, to link Azerbaijan and Europe. Of course, as again Deputy Boyd Barrett has cogently pointed out, these are all loans, obviously the AIIB is claiming after its first year of existence that due diligence on all those loans included all environmental and social impacts, and then of course also entered into these partnerships with the Asian Development Bank and the World Bank in places like Pakistan and Azerbaijan. But again, concerns will remain. Yet the above and forthcoming projects funded by the AIIB will certainly also advance China's own political and economic interests across Asia, and in particular the development of President Xi's, I quote, One Belt, One Road, Ober initiative across Asia, the Asia to Europe development road on the old historic Silk Road. In Ireland's case for joining the AIIB, Minister Noonan, of course, pointed to our trade with China in 2015, which is then worth over $11 billion, and clearly, and especially in context of Brexit, we do need to diversify our export markets, and the vast Chinese market and Asia will be important for Ireland. The Minister of Finance also seemed to base much of his case for entering the AIIB as Ireland's contribution to helping to increase China's integration into the global economy and ensure an appropriate role for the massive Chinese economy in the developing financial architecture. It's notable, however, that only one of the four main development banks, that's the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, which was founded in 1991, has as part of its mandate the provision of loans and assistance to countries, and I quote, which are committed to and applying the principles of multi-party democracy. So effectively, the other three major banks, the IMF, the World Bank and this new bank, they have the similar kind of economic approach, which doesn't overtly concern itself with the levels of democracy in countries which are getting credit from these banks. We have, of course, been members of the World Bank since 1975 and the Asian Development Bank since 2006, and they, as I mentioned, have similar investment principles to the new AIIB. I note that Ireland's allocation in the bank is 1,313 shares or votes, and our subscription to the fund will be €125 million, split between 18-20 between callable and paid in capital, and that the 20%, €25 million, is payable over 5 years. This potential funding liability, of course, looks small compared, for example, to the almost €10 billion callable capital contribution to the European Stability Mechanism. But the AIIB fund, it has an authorised capital stock of $100 billion or €95 billion. And many constituents might be concerned, however, that Ireland's capital contribution from the central fund, according to Minister Noonan when he launched this bill, will be counted as part of the EU target of 0.7% of GNP for overseas development assistance. Apparently, the OECD has recommended that AIIB funding be included in its list of ODA eligible organisations. So people, many constituents might feel this funding won't directly be used to assist the least developed countries, especially in Africa. And we're familiar with bigger countries like the UK and the US, dressing up all kinds of investments which benefits themselves as ODA. China, of course, dominates the AIIB shareholding with almost 29.8% of shares, and is followed by India with 8.4%, Russia with 6.5%, and Germany with 4.5%. And we'd seem to have, Minister, will it be less than 0.1% of shares when the full 77 come on board? Maybe you might give us an indication on what our portion will be. And of course, we'll be representing the Board of Governors, and the Minister for Finance will be Governor for Ireland, and the Board of Governors elects the 12 members of the Board of Directors, and we'll be represented by the director for the euro area. Over recent years, of course, there have been a number of disturbing reports on Chinese, European and American investment in many developing countries where workers, including children, have been very badly treated and exploited. So clearly the European Union, American and Chinese leaderships and all their companies have many questions to answer in relation to the treatment of workers, the exploitation of natural resources and the appropriate nature of infrastructure development. You might recall, Ken Corley, I think there was a particularly shocking report on the cobalt miners of Katanga province in Congo, in the Congo Republic. And cobalt is a critical element, I think, of our mobile phones, which we were talking about at an earlier meeting, and all of our other other IT equipment. So a vital product, but again, these child workers are being treated very badly. So these issues remain to be addressed in Europe, America and China, and the major international investment banks, including this new AIIB, will have a profound responsibility in this regard. And as I said, I am reminded again of the whole situation of the Tibetan and Uyghur nations, which I've often asked Minister Flanagan and his predecessors to constantly raise with China, and to try and ease the repression of the nations and religions of those two states within the People's Republic, and hopefully that our entrance into this bank would not in any way soften or make us more reluctant to make comments about those situations. I've also outlined above some of the other concerns around Ireland joining the AIIB. But given the growth of Irish-Chinese trade, the need to further integrate a huge Chinese economy into the world, and the undoubted benefits to so many Asian countries' infrastructure, which I hope won't be totally critically burdened with loans, I'd give some heavily qualified support for the bill and for entering into the bank. Finally, of course, Ken Corley, Irish accession to this new Asian Development Bank reminds us also of the grave infrastructural deficits in our own country. The price paid by Irish citizens for the outrageous blanket bank guarantee almost 9 years ago continues to hamper our daily lives. The starving of investment for social housing, health and education and transport facilities since late 2008 has seriously damaged our society and produced untold pain. The outgoing Taoiseach, a Minister for Finance, in the last few days in office, by the looks of things, bear a huge responsibility for that situation, Ken Corley. As Fintan O'Toole wrote in yesterday's Irish Times, their craven acquiescence in disastrous EU diktats was shocking and unforgivable. The real context, I believe, of the current Fine Gael leadership campaign, of course, is the profound fear of Fine Gael deputies that their party, based on Kenny and Noonan's legacy, will be decimated at the next election, as Fianna Fáil was in 2011. In any case, it's appalling that Minister Noonan has chosen to override this Dáil and rubbish the so-called new politics to sell over 25% of AIB to pay down national debt. I'm one of those, Ken Corley, who would hold on to all of AIB, or the 99.99% we own, and channel all its future profits and dividends in infrastructure developments, such as social housing, health and education facilities and transport projects like the North Western Motorway, Lewis's for Cork and Galway, Metro North and full Dublin commuter DART. But to proceed with the sale of AIB simply to fulfil barren EU Commission targets makes no sense for Ireland, I believe. It's the hallmark of a failed tenure in the Department of Finance. At the very least, Ken Corley, monies realised from partly privatising AIB should be used for critical infrastructure, perhaps starting with a massive programme of direct-built local authority housing. Any macro cost-benefit analysis for the Irish economy and society would confirm that Minister Noonan's final act is another grave error in a career which I believe has been full of mistakes in public policy and damaging for our people.